Well, thank you, and it's good to be here. I'm honored to be here at the University of Johannesburg this evening, and I want to thank Professor Hansi Bolmerans and the University of Johannesburg, as well as Unsworth Ministries for inviting me to participate in tonight's dialogue. Now, we're in the 21st century, and I think it's fair to say, is it reasonable for us in the 21st century to believe that a person was raised from the dead 2,000 years ago? I think that it is. And this evening, what I'm going to do is I'm going to present a positive historical case for Jesus' resurrection using two major building blocks, facts and method. Let's begin with the facts. I'm not going to use the Gospels this evening. I believe personally that the Gospels are historically reliable sources. Notwithstanding, there is a lot of debate over how reliable the Gospels are. And so rather than get into a lengthy debate on what are the Gospels and how much of them are reliable, I'm going to be appealing exclusively and focusing, for the sake of brevity and simplicity, on literature that was written prior to the Gospels. That's the letters of Paul. Now, Paul was a Jewish leader who lived in the time of Jesus, did not like the church, and he was persecuting the church. And then one day, Paul had an experience that he believed was of the risen Jesus who appeared to him. And it radically transformed his life from a persecutor of the church to one of its most able defenders. Now, just to give you a timeline of how these things unfold, most scholars believe that Jesus was crucified in the year 30. Now, there's some dispute over it, and for practical purposes tonight, it really doesn't matter within these few years. But just to be consistent in the timeline, let's say Jesus was crucified in the year 30. Now, a lot of scholars believe that Paul had his conversion experience somewhere between 1 and 3 years after Jesus' crucifixion. Let's call it 2 years and say Paul had his experience in the year 32. Then, in Paul's letter to the Galatian church, a letter which is undisputedly written by the Apostle Paul, Paul in Galatians 1:18 says that 3 years after his conversion, or 35, he went up to Jerusalem and he visited with Peter, who was the lead apostle and one of Jesus' closest associates, one of the closest disciples. And he also saw James, the brother of Jesus. Now, it's interesting to note that the Greek term that Paul uses here for visit is historesi, from which we get the English word history. So this suggests that Paul's reason for going up to Jerusalem was to get a history of the life and teachings of Jesus. After all, he had not been one of Jesus' disciples. So he wanted the whole nine yards, all the information from those who had been. Then in Galatians chapter 2, Paul says that 14 years later, he went back up to Jerusalem. Now, we don't know if that's 14 years after this first visit or after his conversion experience. So somewhere we have to say around 11 to 14 years later, or the years 46 to 49, Paul goes up to Jerusalem. And he says the objective of his visit this time was to meet with the pillars of the church, Peter, James, and John, the leaders of the Jerusalem church, to run the gospel past them, the message that he had been preaching, and make sure that he hadn't been working in vain. In other words, he wanted to make sure that he was preaching the same thing that they were preaching. And according to Galatians 2, Paul says they added nothing to what he had to say. They gave him the right hand of fellowship, meaning they were saying, "You got it, Paul. Good job, brother. Keep up the good work." And we don't have to just take Paul's word on it. Polycarp and Clement of Rome were probably disciples of the apostles John and Peter, respectively. And so if Paul was preaching something different in his core teachings than Peter and John were, and they were two of the three pillars, then we would expect Clement and Polycarp to chide Paul and correct him on it. After all, when they're writing, Paul's dead, so they don't have to worry about him writing some sarcastic, nasty response. But when we go to Paul's letter, the letters of Polycarp and 1 Clement, we find Clement saying that Paul accurately and reliably taught the message of truth. We find that he placed Paul on par with his mentor Peter. We find that Polycarp referred to the blessed Paul and quoted from his writings and referred to them as part of the sacred scriptures. These are not the kinds of things that you say if the person is preaching something completely different than your mentor was. But it is the kind of thing that you would say if they were preaching exactly the same sort of things that your mentors were. I could give more, but that should, for brevity's sake, that should serve to show that Paul is preaching the essential, fundamental, foundational doctrines that the Jerusalem apostles were. So that when we come to reading Paul's letters, we are also hearing, as in terms of the core doctrines, the voice of the Jerusalem apostles. Now, a couple of years after this, in the year around 51, Paul goes up to a Mediterranean city named Corinth, and he starts a church there. And then a few years later, 53 to 55, he writes a letter to that church responding and answering a bunch of those questions, their questions, a letter we now call 1 Corinthians. In chapter 15 of that letter, he's going to discuss a bunch of things about the resurrection, so we'll focus on that in a moment. Now, just to give you a little idea when the Gospels were written, we're not quite sure exactly when they were written. Scholars differ, and very honestly, we can't have pinpoint precision on it. But just to give you an idea on the standard dating of the Gospels, most scholars believe that Mark was the first Gospel written, and he writes 10 to 15 years later, between 65 to 70, or 35 to 40 years after Jesus' crucifixion. That's pretty good by ancient standards to have a biography within 30 to 40 years of the original. Of the person, the subject's life. But it's not like we don't have anything about Jesus in the meantime anyway. We've got a lot in terms of what we can get from the Apostle Paul in his undisputed letters at least. Now, let's talk about 1 Corinthians chapter 15. Oh, by the way, a couple of facts here. I told you we were going to present facts and method, or five facts. Fact number one is that Paul had an experience that he believed what he made him an eyewitness of the risen Jesus. Two, Paul knew Jesus' disciples. Three, Paul taught what they taught. All right, now let's look at what they were teaching. 1 Corinthians 15 is a chapter all about resurrection. And he writes this, "I delivered to you at first what I also received." Now, most scholars who write on the subject agree that Paul here is imparting to the church oral tradition that had been passed along to him. And one of the reasons for believing this, there are many, but one of the reasons are these two terms here that I have italicized, delivered and received. These were commonly used as technical terms for the imparting of oral tradition. Now, what is it that is being passed along? He says that Christ died for our sins according to the Scriptures, and that he was buried, and that he was raised on the third day according to the Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, then to the 12, then to more than 500 brethren at one time, among whom most remain alive until now, but some have died. Then he appeared to James, then to all of the apostles. Last of all, is to one untimely born, he appeared also to me. Now, what's interesting to note here is that there are six resurrection appearances. Three are to individuals, and three to groups. The three individuals are Peter, James, and Paul. Now, remember, Paul met with Peter and James now on two occasions. So he's giving firsthand testimony. And then, of course, Paul knows himself. So we get some really good testimony firsthand from three people here. The three group appearances to the 12, to more than 500, and to all the apostles are really good because they suggest that these are not subjective group psychological natural experiences, because modern psychology seems to indicate that group natural psychological phenomena within group experiences, like we're referring to with these appearances, don't occur. Now, that brings us to our fourth fact, and that is they taught that Jesus appeared to individuals and to groups, to friend and foe alike. Fact number five, they taught that Jesus was raised physically. And this, I suppose, is probably going to be one of the main contentions between Professor Craffert and myself this evening. I'm contending that they taught that Jesus was raised physically, bodily, from the dead, leaving behind an empty grave. Now, where do I get this? Especially if I'm not using the Gospels. Five times throughout Paul's letters, he says that the way that we Christians will be raised from the dead in the future is the way Jesus was raised. One such reference is 1 Corinthians 15:20, when Paul says, "Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who sleep." Now, first fruits is an agricultural term referring to the first of the crops to be harvested. You ever grew a garden in your backyard, a tomato plant or something, some tomatoes or those plants become ripe before the others, so they're the first fruits, the first to be picked. So Paul and the early Christians are saying that Jesus is the first fruits, the first to be raised from the dead with a resurrection-type body. Those who are asleep are referring to the dead. Well, then when's everybody else going to be raised from the dead? Three verses later, Paul answers this. He says, "But each in his own order, Christ the first fruits. After that, those who are Christ's at his coming." So according to the early Christians, Jesus was raised first in Paul's day, and then Everyone else will be raised from the dead at Jesus' second coming. So what happens in the meantime when a believer dies? Elsewhere in Paul's undisputed letters, 2 Corinthians 5:8, Paul says to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. In Philippians 1:23 and 24, he gives the options. You can die and be with Christ or remain on in the body. So the picture we get from Paul is that when a Christian dies prior to the second coming of Christ, so let's say I'm flying back to Atlanta on Thursday, and the plane ditches in the Atlantic Ocean. Those things happen sometimes. Hopefully not on my trip. By the way, it's not the drop out of the sky that kills you. It's the sudden stop. That's what I hear when you're in a plane crash. But so if I were to die, let's say going back to Atlanta, according to Paul, what will happen is my spirit will leave the body. I become a disembodied spirit. I ascend to be with Christ in heaven, and I remain there with him as a disembodied spirit until he returns. Then he brings back those with those who have died in Christ. And then we are reunited with our bodies, which are then resurrected and changed, transformed into immortal, glorious, powerful body that's animated by the Holy Spirit. So it's a physical, bodily resurrection we're talking about here. And if we're going to be raised as Jesus was raised, and if our bodies are going to be raised, then that means that they were teaching that Jesus' physical corpse had been raised from the dead. And we're getting this in our earliest accounts. So those are our five facts. That brings me now to my second major building block, and that's method. Now, professional historians generally use a number of criteria, and I'm referring to historians outside of the community of biblical scholars who have spent a great deal of time studying the philosophy of history and historical method. And when I did my doctoral work at Tufts, that's where the areas I focused, historiographical considerations and the resurrection of Jesus. I wanted to know, with over 3,300 academic sources written on the resurrection since 1975, why there were so many differences and how many of the people writing had actually had training in the philosophy of history and historical method. Most places who train biblical scholars and philosophers don't offer that kind of training. So that's the kind of stuff that I engage in. I just consumed, my reading was consumed with matters related to the philosophy of history and historical method. And historians generally employ four criteria for the best explanation. And the best explanation is regarded as what probably occurred. The first is called explanatory scope. The first thing a historian wants to do is to look at all of the data, and they want to form hypotheses that can account for all of the data. Think of putting together a jigsaw puzzle and all these different jigsaw puzzle pieces. Your solution wants to incorporate all the pieces of the puzzle and not leave some stranded. If every piece of the puzzle represents a historical fact, you want to include all of the facts and not just some of them. The hypothesis that can account for the greatest number of facts is to be preferred. Explanatory power is the ability of a hypothesis to account for the data without forcing them to fit or without excessive ambiguity. So you could force and make, you know, you take a piece of puzzle and you know you can make it fit and you kind of push it, but you know it doesn't go there. You have to force it. You don't want to do that with some of the data to make it force your hypothesis. And you don't want to leave it so ambiguous as it really doesn't explain much. Almost like a can't catch me. Ad hoc is a Latin term that's referring to non-evidenced assumptions. So I don't want to have some presuppositions involved. Like, I definitely wouldn't want to argue for the resurrection by saying, well, I'm presupposing that the Bible is inspired by God and without any error. Therefore, the resurrection happened because the Bible teaches that way. Well, that would be a non-evidenced assumption. And the hypothesis that has the least number of non-evidenced assumptions is to be preferred. Finally is plausibility. You want something that is in agreement with other widely accepted facts. Now, let me go over the resurrection hypothesis with you very quickly, and then I'm going to sit down. The resurrection hypothesis is that I'm using this evening is that Jesus rose physically, bodily from the dead. Now let's look at this hypothesis based on the data we have, the five facts that I discussed. If Jesus rose from the dead, does that explain why a number of people had experiences that they perceived were the risen Jesus who appeared to them in individual and in group settings, to friend and foe alike, and it led them to the belief that Jesus had been physically, bodily raised from the dead? Sure. Does it do it without forcing the facts to fit? Sure. Does it do it without any ambiguity? Right. I'm saying right up front. I'm not leaving it ambiguous to say, well, they believe Jesus rose from the dead, but we don't know in what sense he was raised. No, I'm saying they believed he was raised physically from the dead. So it doesn't lack explanatory. It passes these first two criteria very well. Is it ad hoc? Are there any non-evidenced assumptions? I don't think so. At most, someone could say, well, Mike, you're assuming that God exists. Well, no, I'm not, because I haven't argued that God raised Jesus from the dead. That's a separate question. My question right now was Jesus raised? It's oftentimes we can, in the practice of history, we can conclude a historical event occurred without arguing for the cause of it. We do this in science all the time. Physicists do it. They posit theoretical entities like black holes, quarks, strings, and gluons. These things have never been observed, probably never will. But they're theoretical entities used to explain phenomena that we see. In the same way, with the resurrection of Jesus, we could say, oh, he was raised from the dead. Now that's kind of interesting. How did that occur? And then we could posit a theoretical entity like God. But whatever we do, whether we say it's God or some alien in a parallel universe is doing his PhD experiment to see if he could deceive human beings to conclude that Jesus is God or that he was God and he's just a poser, who knows? You know, I'm not arguing one way or another tonight. I think God's the best candidate if Jesus was raised, but I'm not arguing that. And even if I did argue for God's existence, it's far from being a non-evidence assumption. I think there's very good evidence for God's existence from philosophy and science, like the astrophysics, like the cosmological constants in the universe, and the flatness factor that's a result of the Big Bang. And there are lots of different ways that I could argue from astrophysics and molecular biology for an intelligent designer of the universe and life itself. So it's not non-evidence assumption. There is evidence for God's existence. So I don't think that this is ad hoc at all. Now, plausibility, I do think it's a little challenging for me. Plausibility means, is it in agreement with other widely accepted facts? Now, I'll be the first to admit, it's not widely accepted that people were raised from the dead, at least by natural causes. I think we'd all agree, whether we're a Christian or whatever we believe, that the dead are not raised by natural causes. But if Jesus was raised from the dead, let's face it, it probably was a unique event performed by a deity for a specific purpose. And so we wouldn't expect these things to be happening all the time. And if God existed and wanted to raise Jesus, well, I think we'd all agree that that's not at all implausible. It would be widely accepted that if God exists and wanted to raise Jesus, that he would and could. But I don't want to make such assumptions like that. So to be honest with you, I haven't got my arms around the plausibility thing completely yet. I don't think it's implausible, but I don't want to play around with it and trying to position how I explain it in such a way as to cheat. So in favor of my hypothesis. So for plausibility, I'm just going to say it doesn't pass, but it doesn't fail either. So here's the bottom line. Let me just summarize what I've said over the last 19 minutes. I presented a positive historical case for Jesus' physical, bodily resurrection from the dead using two major building blocks, facts and method. I presented those five facts, and then for my method, I gave four general criteria for comparing hypotheses for the best explanation. And I showed how the resurrection hypothesis fulfills three of the four with flying colors and does not fail the fourth. So we have a pretty good hypothesis here. And unless and until, someone can come up with a hypothesis that fulfills those criteria at least as well, if not better, then we should conclude as students of history that the resurrection of Jesus was an event that occurred in history. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, you've heard Mike answering the question, was Jesus physically resurrected, with a clear yes. Now, if you expect me to argue now no, then you're at the wrong place. Then you should probably leave. I have been hesitant to participate in this event, and I still am skeptical. But as you know, a skeptic is a person who keeps an open mind. I hope I will be surprised. But as it stands, academically, it's uncomfortable to answer this question, if not embarrassing, to participate in a discussion where the question was Jesus physically resurrected. I say it is academically embarrassing because without realizing it, the question already contains an interpretation of the data. Let me explain this with another example. In the early 1920s, Cecilia Payne, a student in astrophysics at Harvard University, was forced to insert a very humiliating line in her published dissertation. Up to that point, scientists believed that the sun was 66% consists of 66% iron. She looked at the spectroscopic data, and she concluded that the sun probably consists of 90% hydrogen, with the rest being helium. So she had to insert the following in her thesis: the enormous abundance of hydrogen is almost certainly not real. Today, there is not a single sun as iron theorist left in the world, not even at Harvard. But imagine the embarrassment if someone is asked to answer the question, but do you really think the sun consists of 66% iron? You see, the question about the bodily or physical resurrection is precisely like this question, because it can be answered only by a yes or a no. In other words, the question already presupposes a modern understanding of what needs to be determined. The notion of a physical resurrection is already an interpretation of the biblical text, which I want to suggest can be interpreted differently. What if the biblical texts never were about a physical resurrection? In what follows, I will suggest a cultural sensitive understanding of the biblical data that will show why the notion of a physical resurrection in any modern sense of the word is indeed like the sun as iron theory. Indeed, not the best interpretation of the data. It will be suggested that the biblical texts probably never were talking about a physical resurrection in any modern sense of the word. Now, you should not miss the implicit point I'm making here. If you do not, or even if you do not agree with my interpretation, what cannot be denied is that the same biblical text can be understood differently. Now, therefore, the question should at the very least be, what is the best interpretation of the data? If not, is the notion of Jesus' physical resurrection still defendable? And not, was Jesus physically resurrected? Almost everything I know about this discussion and this debate focuses on this question, and I'm suggesting that we should seriously look at the way we've posed the question and in a certain sense set people up to answer the question that we already have predetermined. Honestly, I have to say this, there are many more challenges at this university. I would like to have a cathedral where I can at least put my notes down to read it, because I have to have a very specific point of focus there. So, but as you said, it's you, Jay. In what follows, I will show you what can be seen when looking at the data by means of cultural sensitive lenses. It will be pointed out that the notion of a physical resurrection is but one possible interpretation of the data. However, that it is probably like the sun as iron theory, not the best interpretation of the data. In order to argue this point, let me start with an illustrative story. In a study on alternative states of consciousness, short AECs, the anthropologist Bruce Grindel tells us that on the night of 23 October 1967, he witnessed the raising of the dead during a Sisala funerary ceremony. Grindel describes the experience during which he himself entered the consensual reality of the Sisala, that is a clan in Ghana. He describes this as a life-altering event that also changed his self-perception. Upon inquiring, he discovered that many of the clan members experienced precisely the same thing, where the deceased drummer of the clan was raised up to play the drums on the roof of the hut. For the locals, it was an experience that merely confirmed beliefs and tradition, and therefore was very real and natural. Grindel, however, entered their consensual reality and experienced the raising of the dead drummer through introduction to their cultural beliefs, while the circumstances of the few days of the funeral rituals prepared him for that experience. As an anthropologist, he is fully aware that while real for the locals, and as real as anything else in his own life, this was an experience of an altered state of consciousness. Broadly speaking, I take this as an example of an academically responsible and intellectually defensible historiography. What Mike said about historical method, I fully agree with him. The only point is, he's just not complete, because historiography do not only work with that, and I will try to give you some indication of historical method, because I'm saying that what Grindel did as a historian here is precisely what historians have to do when they deal with data, the kind of data he had to deal with. Broadly speaking, I take this as an example. So let me give you just a clue of some of the elements that we have to take into account. Grindel knows perfectly well that 90% of the world's population today, and even more in former times, live in consensual realities that take AECs such as dreams and visions as normal, natural, and common ways of obtaining knowledge about the world. The team of anthropologists and neuroscientists, Lachlan, McManus, and the Quilly maintain, I refer to their work, many people, the majority on the planet, accept and experience what is called polyphasic consciousness, in which many states of consciousness, such as dreams and visions, are taken as real and are often experienced. Such cultures often provide the rituals and prescriptions for the how, when, and who of these experiences. Secondly, Grindel's interpretation contains an acknowledgement that reality for all of us, me, you, the Sisala, and Jesus' first followers, despite being presented as if objectively there, is consensual reality that contains elements that are real but do not necessarily exist out there. Grindel emphasizes that the reality of his experience could not have been recorded by some kind of recording device, because he knows that reality is relative to one's consciousness of it. At the same time, he acknowledges that precisely such collectively constructed consensus realities are what all of us take to be real. Thirdly, the reverse side of this coin, none of us occupy or have access to reality pure and simple, but we only have constructed maps consisting of the world out there, our neural processes in the brain, and community approval. The neuroscientist Andrew Newberg says, and I quote him extensively here, "To me, as a neuroscientist, what is amazing about our perceptual process is not how accurate it is, but how real it makes the world appear. Ultimately, it is one of the most functionally useful human processes. That is why our individual sense of reality is the primary belief from which all other beliefs emerge. What the neuroscientific research has found is that your perceptions of reality and your beliefs are inextricably intertwined. Your sense of reality depends primarily on three criteria: the subjective vividness of the experience, the continuity and duration of the experience in time and space, and the consensus of others on what is considered real." Finally, Grindel realizes that the world is populated by means of numerous consensual realities. In fact, from the perspective of neurosciences, you will learn that there are probably 6 billion consensus realities, while anthropologists tell us that many of these can be grouped together in patterns. One such pattern adopted by the majority of people on the planet is that they accept AECs like dreams, visions, revelations as building blocks of reality and knowledge-providing experiences. What is, however, universal to all of these consensus realities is that each and every one of them appear to be real and object-like. Hopefully, this gives you a glimpse of the theoretical framework I am suggesting for understanding the data about Jesus' resurrection. It is a framework that realizes people live in different cultural realities and that what they report is not only real for them, but relative to that framework. Death divination for the Sisala is as real as patriotism is for you and me, and afterlife experiences of deceased ancestors were for first century Israelites. Now, I use this example of patriotism. I don't know whether you know what it is. It is that, I don't know whether you know the phenomenon where people make a lot of noise, and they take a cloth and they put it on the pole, and then adult men will stand there and cry. With the World Cup coming up, you will probably see it. We call it an anthem and we call it a flag, as an expression of patriotism. I use this as an example to say, reality is culturally constructed and culturally approved. This is just one example in our world. I'm suggesting that patriotism, death divination for the Sisala, and afterlife experiences for many people are precisely the same kind of reality experiences. Now, the contrast between this interpretive framework and what is going on in Jesus' research in general, and the resurrection debate in particular, cannot be overemphasized. It is the difference between answering yes or no to a presupposed understanding of the data versus what the data is about. What is taken for granted in responsible cross-cultural historiography, that is, writing history, is virtually absent in Jesus' research. And what is absent, there occupies central position in Jesus' research. Let me tell you, and you must have noticed that, totally absent from the Sisala example are speculations about the kind of body the drummer occupied, whether the visual experiences were merely hallucinations, or whether that event was really real. Now, I am not suggesting that the biblical data are in fact about ASCs. I am merely suggesting that a different theoretical and historiographical framework be taken as point of departure. In fact, the biblical texts are read as if they, in traditional readings, as if they are talking about events and phenomena in our world. New Testament historiography consists of listings and counting textual references. Three independent texts state that Jesus was touched by his followers, therefore his body was physical. So many independent texts claim he was seen, therefore the body must have been physical or material. Jesus walked, ate and spoke, and therefore must have occupied a physical body. Now, the sun is iron theory is possible, but is it likely? Now, let me illustrate this problem with one example. The problem referring to the way New Testament scholars list and list what the texts are saying, and because the text and so many witnesses say this, it must have happened or it must have been real. Let me illustrate this with one element in that features in this whole debate. Anyone familiar with the text or the debate about Jesus' resurrection will know that seeing is central to it. The text repeatedly state that the disciples saw Jesus or he appeared to them. And in the debate, there are basically two understandings. Either it was literal, normal seeing, that is normally conservative or apologetic scholars, or these were hallucinations, that's mostly the critical scholars. Since everybody knows the difference between seeing and hallucination, for conservative scholars, the sightings were real scenes because nobody will make such claims based on hallucinations. And for critical scholars, hallucinations are illusions. And since these were hallucinations, they cannot be used to claim a bodily or physical resurrection. The shared theoretical position is that seeing refers either to objective visual perception or to hallucinations, also referred to as subjective visions. Compared to the Sisala example, both sides seem ignorant about the body of anthropological research showing that visionary experiences for many people on the planet are neither objective nor hallucinations. But both sides also seem oblivious to the cognitive neuroscientific research that has overturned our common fallacy about visual perception. Humans do not merely see what is out there, but seeing is a neurological process where believing is as much as seeing, where believing is seeing as much as seeing is believing. Both the psychologist Susan Blackmore and the neuroscientist V.S. Ramachandran points to the common fallacy about vision that thinks about seeing as a transfer of images from the retina to the brain. It is rather the case, they say, that electrochemical impulses are streaming into the brain where they are processed in numerous places by means of complex processes into visual consciousness, with far-reaching implications for claims about external reality. Any visual perception is as much dependent on what is out there as what happens in the brain. Prior knowledge and beliefs, emotional attachment, the ability of the brain to fill in the gaps, as well as peer group confirmation, are all essential or play a role for the electrochemical impulses to be turned into visual perception and consciousness. If anything, the neuroscientific research on visual perception does not at all support the outdated dualism of objective seeing versus hallucinations mentioned above. A very tiny bit of this can be illustrated by means of research into so-called optical illusions. I have a picture here I want to show to you. I don't know whether you see that bright square there. Do you see it, Mike?
Yes.
Yes. Okay, you can send it around. Now, this is just a very small example to illustrate something. A very tiny bit of this can be illustrated by optical illusions. Optical illusions such as seeing curved lines when they are straight, seeing a bright square where there is none, show that our brains can construct reality which does not exist. There is no bright square on that paper. There are only four semi-circles on that paper. But your brain, so how on earth can you see a white square there which is not there? You see, it's a very simple, and for this I can take the whole evening of this complex process of how reality is constructed, how reality is constructed in this negotiated process between our brains, the world out there, and the agreement, intersubjective agreement of communities. We all live in realities that seems perfectly objective to our best neurological processes, but they all remain negotiated constructs based on prior knowledge about the world, emotions, and the neurological structures we were born with. Now, with these theoretical tools in mind, that what I've listed from the multiple cultural realities, polyphasic cultures, the way we see, etc., let us look at the biblical evidence. You should note that, as with the Sisal example, responsible historiography is not a matter of counting independent witnesses. In other words, listing texts saying Jesus was touched, the disciples touched him, or he ate and spoke, and therefore it is the case. But first asking what the data is evidence for. That is, interpreting the data by means, by taking their consensus reality seriously. The people who said they saw Jesus and touched him and ate with him after his death are people sharing a particular cultural consensus reality. So what do we know about that reality? I will only point to some elements. We know from numerous texts that visions and apocalyptic experiences were extremely common among Jewish people at the time. The New Testament itself is packed with such experiences. Luke contains at least 25 reports about people having dream or visionary experiences, while in Revelation John tells us at least four times about his heavenly revelation. Paul's letter contains stories about heavenly journeys, out-of-body experiences, and visionary experiences, while the Gospels contain numerous references to such experiences, such as during Jesus' baptism. We also know that the same people who told the stories about Jesus' resurrection also told stories about seeing and speaking to angels, demons, and evil spirits. I have never come across a serious study speculating about the physicality of the angels or the demons who could speak. We know in order to speak you need a physical body to force air across the vocal cords, as well as have learned a particular language. But in dreams and visionary experiences, that for the brain are as real as any event in time-space, angels, demons, animals, and even deceased ancestors, who, by the way, have you ever thought about it, could be identified in a world where there were no photos. Who on earth would ever know who that ancestor was? But all of these entities could perform normal human activities like speaking and eating. Furthermore, we know that biblical people tell stories about visual experiences as if they happened in space-time. Look again at the Old Testament stories of angels disguised as hungry visitors. Just take one example from the New Testament, the Transfiguration story. It is reported like an event in space-time where Jesus and three disciples went up a mountain, two ancestors, Moses and Elijah, appeared, and the disciples wanted to erect tents, and they heard voices speaking to them. It is reported like a normal event in space-time, but when coming down the mountain, Matthew explicitly have Jesus saying, "Tell no one the vision." You will never have thought about it, that it was a vision, because the story was told like any other event in the Gospels. By the way, if you want to interpret these texts literally as if they were events in space-time, you'll have to say that Jesus was not the first, but probably the third Jewish person next to Moses and Elijah to have been resurrected from the dead. We also know that for first century Jewish people, deceased ancestors were part of their everyday life. We know that the tombs of numerous holy ancestors were venerated in Jesus' day. Just look at the casual way in which the Gospels tell us about this belief. In a number of texts, both Jesus and John the Baptist are questioned about their identity. Who do the people say that I am? And in each instance, the answer suggests that they could be revived ancestors. Elijah, one of the prophets. It is even suggested that Jesus was John the Baptist revived. The tacit assumption in all of these accounts is that deceased ancestors could be around, or that the body of someone could be possessed or filled by an ancestral spirit or soul, and in that way assume the body of that ancestor or spirit. Such was their consensus reality. We know that when justifying to the Corinthians why they should believe in Jesus' resurrection, Paul explicitly calls on Jesus' appearances. Now, his own report, I think Mike has referred to that, as well as the Lucan accounts of his own Damascus experience, clearly describe it as a visionary or a revelatory experience. Paul tells us that the disciples had visionary experiences, and the gospel accounts, just like the Configuration story, report about such experiences as if events in space-time. Matthew, Luke, and John contain reports of the woman who saw an angel, or angels, or men in white clothes at the tomb, and they all report it as if normal seeing. Besides, all the features of visionary experiences, Luke explicitly says in Emmaus stories, that the woman reported to the disciples that they saw a vision of angels. You see, if you read it again, it looks like normal reports about normal events in space-time. And then Luke again gives us a clue there. We know that when speculating about the nature of resurrected bodies, Paul relies on a very particular trend in Jewish thought, one that I call the astronomical complex. At the time, there were many different views on the afterlife, in the first century time. The typical Greek Platonic view depended on an immortal soul inside the body that will survive death. While many Jewish people did not even entertain the idea of an afterlife, for example, the Sadducees, others expressed their beliefs in terms of resurrection. But they all do not agree on precisely what resurrection means. There were Jewish people who thought that resurrection would be simply a revival of a body, a continuation of this body. Paul, however, and I think if you want to understand 1 Corinthians 15, what his speculation about this, I'm suggesting Paul, however, relies on the mystical thought in Jewish tradition, which links the body of the wise with the stars or the angels. Not everybody, but the sages will continue life as stars. We find this idea in Daniel 12, who says that sages will shine like the stars. Now, this connection between the stars and divinity is even older than Jewish thought. I'm suggesting that Paul is leading up to this instead of the Platonic idea of an immortal soul. Paul is leading up to this Jewish idea of the transformation of the sages into star-like or angel-like beings. According to their physics, either everything consisted of, according to their physics, I mean physics in the first century world, roughly in that Greco-Roman world, everything consisted of configurations of four elements: fire, air, earth, and water. According to this mystical Jewish tradition, resurrected sages will occupy the same kind of bodies that make up the stars and the angels. In other words, bodies of a different composition. Spiritual bodies, in this view, are still bodies, but unlike fleshly bodies, of a different configuration of the basic elements of their physics. Given their consensus reality, it can be detected from all the above and the specific evidence in the New Testament. I'm suggesting that the best interpretation of the biblical data is that after his death, Jesus' followers had culturally approved experiences, fully embedded in their consensus reality, and based on that claim that after his death he appeared to them in a first century culturally approved physical body. They used the term resurrection, which at the time was well known to express one version of Israelite afterlife beliefs, to name this reality. Given their consensus reality and their experiences, they were fully convinced, just like the Sisala were about the death divination of the drummer, about Jesus' physical bodily resurrection. The circle of Jesus' first followers, and at least Paul, did not need historical or scientific evidence that Jesus was literally bodily resurrected, because visionary experiences informed by notions about the potentialities of the human body, together with existing resurrection beliefs, were sufficient for them to make precisely that claim. For them, such experiences could very well have served as basis for a firm belief that Jesus was raised bodily, in their sense of the word, from the dead. Read from a cultural sensitive point of view, a new appreciation for the New Testament data can be developed. Like Grindel, who as an anthropologist had appreciation for the cultural view and consensus reality of the Sisala people, the cultural reality of Jesus' resurrection can even today be endorsed. Like death divination among the Sisala, we can and should respect their cultural reality for what it was, but it is not necessary to elevate it to an objective event. In this sense, it can be said, yes, Jesus was resurrected in a first century Mediterranean body, in terms of events and processes making sense to them and fitting their cultural system. If you cannot imagine that for some people reality is created also by visionary experiences, you will probably not be able to understand most of these reports. We can continue forever debating whether the text says Jesus was bodily or physically resurrected or not. If we do not start asking whether that is what the texts are about, the discussion will endlessly continue along the same lines. If you think the issue is whether the text indeed claim or say what they saw, or that they touched him, I think then the discovery of 100 new gospels supporting that will confirm a physical resurrection and finally refute those who doubt it. The point I'm trying to make is, if your only historical method is to look for more and more data saying the same thing, then if more texts were to be discovered, it will confirm that. However, if you realize that the world is filled with numerous consensus realities, and that the above-mentioned data refer to events within one such reality, then the discovery of even 100 new Gospels will merely affirm the interpretive problem. What are these texts evidence for? In my view, the notion of a physical resurrection in our sense of the term is neither what the texts are about and nor the best interpretation of the data. In conclusion, I want to return to the reason why I am embarrassed to participate in the question as formulated here. It was when discussing the Sisala example that it was pointed out that Grindel did not speculate about the kind of body the drummer occupied, but those kind of issues are central in New Testament circles. What is the difference and why is it the case? Now, I think the theoretical difference is that as trained anthropologist, Grindel does two things. He endorsed the consensus reality of the Sisala for what it is, and like all responsible cross-cultural historiography, historiography avoided ethnocentrism. That is, he avoided the practice of judging others by our light and standards. Understanding why these features are lacking in New Testament historiography could help us move beyond them. I will start with two facts that we will probably all agree on. The first is that for nearly 2,000 years, Christians have believed that Jesus was literally, physically, bodily resurrected from the dead. The majority, if not all Christians today, and throughout history believed it, not based on evidence or argument, or because it has been proven, but based on tradition, belief, and confession. It was like this ever since the second generation of disciples, when Paul in his first letter to the Corinthians says, "For I delivered to you as of first importance what I also received." And part of that is transmitted, and part of what is transmitted is that Jesus was raised from the dead, or as he says in verse 11, "So we proclaim and you believe." Now this is not unlike the beliefs of the Sisala about death divination, that is confirmed by experience, while experience is fed by beliefs. Therefore, I think Dale Ellison is correct when he observes, maybe then it is not so surprising that most who believe in Jesus' resurrection, however exactly they understand it, have as little need for modern historical criticism as birds have for ornithology. Dale Martin refers to such historical justifications of the Christian consensus reality as modernist imperialism that is theologically offensive to millions of Christians. Now my second point, the second fact is that, which we probably all will also agree on, but probably not with my interpretation. The second fact is that the century-old Christian conviction of Jesus' bodily resurrection came to an end towards the latter part of the 18th century with the emergence of a scientific view of the world when, at least among the intellectual elite, rationalism replaced Christianity as the central ideology of the Western world. Critical New Testament studies started as an ethnocentric rejection of the two greatest miracles in the Christian tradition. The rationalist ethnocentric attack on the consensus reality of Christianity met with apologetic ethnocentric defense of the same magnitude. I quote Nynum here, he says, inevitably, apologists for Christianity felt obliged to meet such opponents on their own grounds. I think the time has come to acknowledge that both the rational rejection and apologetic defense are operating on exactly the same ethnocentric playing field. The point I'm making is that the apologetic defense of a physical resurrection started some 200 years ago and continued on an ethnocentric theoretical path that could not acknowledge the consensus reality of Christians for what it was. Christian apologetics, like critical scholarship, is today still defined by this original starting point. As the Sisala study shows, neither apologetics nor critical scholars. Three, thank you. I will be done. As the Sisala study shows, neither apologetics nor critical scholarship need to include an ethnocentric rejection or defense of any consensus reality. However, despite the fact that such realities are all presented as object-like and have the status of reality for insiders, none has universal validity. Besides endorsing them, critical scholarship can also apply analytical concepts, such as altered states of consciousness, to any or all of such cultural constructs. However, instead of being sidetracked onto the ethnocentric yes or no of a physical resurrection, it seems to me that one of the real challenges Christian theology is facing is coming to terms with its consensus reality. And if you think a theology can only be true and meaningful if it is based on hard, material, physical events, I think you understand very little about human realities, and for that matter, about the way in which God was revealed for them in these cultural events. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Professor Craffert. I do want to say that I've studied the resurrection and the literature on it for some time now, And I believe that Professor Crawford's proposal that he's given this evening is one of the most innovative and fresh approaches to the resurrection that we've seen in decades. So I want to compliment him on that. But as Professor Crawford said in his opening speech, he said, some biblical texts can be understood differently. The question is, which is the best explanation? And that's why the criteria for the best explanation, the method that I discussed and that professional historians use, is so important. So tonight, in this speech, what I'm going to do is I'm going to review my case for the resurrection of Jesus based on Professor Crawford's comments. Again, I built a positive historical case for Jesus' resurrection using two major building blocks, facts and method. So let's review these. First, the facts. Here I presented five facts related to Jesus' resurrection. The first had to do with Paul being an eyewitness. He had experience that he believed he was an eyewitness of the risen Jesus. Two, Paul knew Jesus' disciples. Three, Paul taught what they taught. Four, they taught the appearances to individuals and groups, to friends and fellow alike. And five, they taught that Jesus had been raised physically from the dead. And as I suspected, Professor Crawford didn't contend with the first four, but he did with the fifth. And he said he doesn't believe that they were saying that Jesus appeared physically in his corpse. Instead, they were describing experiences that had occurred in an altered state of consciousness. Now, I wholeheartedly agree with Professor Crawford that the early Christians had experiences throughout their lives in which they experienced what they believed was the divine while in altered state of consciousness. For example, they experienced them in dreams, trances, and visions. Just to give you an idea, there's four dreams that are reported in the New Testament in Matthew that Joseph, Mary's husband, had about, first of all, Joseph, you can go ahead and take Mary for your wife because the child she has in her is of the Holy Spirit. Or get out of Bethlehem, Herod's seeking to kill you. Or it's okay now to go back. Those kinds of things. It says that occurred in dreams. Trances. Acts chapter 10, it says Peter went up to the roof around midday, somewhere around that, and he fell into a trance, and then he had a vision of a sheep coming down from heaven, things like that. Visions, when Stephen was being stoned, he had a vision. He saw something that no one else saw. He saw Jesus standing at the right hand of God. So, yes, I agree with him completely that just as today people have experiences with an altered states of consciousness, they had them in antiquity as well. The difference would be in that culture, as opposed to Western culture, they recognize, I agree with him here, they recognize that these were actual events. They thought that these were communications of the divine to them, just as something that occurred in an ordinary state of consciousness, an OSC. So I agree with that. What Professor Crawford didn't say is that they also had experiences of what they believed was the divine or supernatural that occurred in space-time. They believed occurred in space-time in ordinary states of consciousness. For example, in Acts chapter 12, Peter's in prison, and an angel comes and releases him. The chains drop off of him, says, get up, Pete, let's go. And I'm getting you out of here. And Peter goes ahead and gets up, and he thinks he's having a dream. This is occurring in a dream, in an altered state of consciousness. But he says as he's walking, he comes to realize that it's real. In fact, the Greek term alethes is used there. True. It's a true event. In other words, he's out of jail, so it's occurring in space-time. This wasn't in an altered state of consciousness. I could give several other examples. Let me just give one more. What about the raising of Lazarus that's reported? Are we to say, to be culturally sensitive, that this occurred in an altered state of consciousness, an ASC? As though, come on, y'all, let's get together. I know you're grieving over Lazarus, but let me lead you into a trance, and you can seance, and you can talk to him. No, because Jesus called Lazarus out of the tomb, commanded the others to unwrap him, and then he remained with them for some time. Experiences in altered state of consciousness are very short, maybe 15 minutes, but they're very short. They don't go on for days and weeks and months. And then the Jewish leaders plan to kill Lazarus, who Jesus had raised from the dead. You don't do this to someone in an altered state of consciousness. You don't kill someone in a dream. So if we want to be culturally sensitive, we've got to take the text for what they said and not try to see in them something that's not really there. I could give several more. So the question is now, we know that the New Testament Christians, the early ones, believed that events could occur in an ordinary state of consciousness as well. But when we come to the resurrection appearances, how did they regard these? I want to argue that they believed and they wrote in the text that they occurred in an ordinary state of consciousness. When you look through the New Testament report, some of the examples I just showed, when they believe that they occurred in an altered state of consciousness, like dreams, visions, and trances, it always notes it. It happened in a dream. Or Peter went up and he fell into a trance and had a vision. Things like this. We don't find such language in the resurrection narratives. It's completely absent. Second, the Gospels are pretty clear. There's an empty tomb and the corpse is missing. This is completely unnecessary if they were reporting that these appearances occurred in an altered state of consciousness. But it is very common, very at home, if they're reporting that it happened in an ordinary state of consciousness. If that's not enough, how about Acts chapter 13? Paul couldn't be clearer here. He says that Jesus rose from the dead in fulfillment of Acts chapter 6, or Psalm 16, verse 10, which says, "You will not allow your Holy One to decay." And he said David wrote this, but he couldn't have been referring to himself because David died, was buried, and his body decayed. Jesus, on the other hand, died, was buried. His body didn't decay. Instead, God raised it up. How could you be any more clear that you're claiming that this event of the resurrection occurred in space-time? The appearances occurred in an ordinary state of consciousness, not an altered state of consciousness. Fourth, I argued that Paul's view of resurrection was that it happened to the corpse. It was physical. And here, remember, I compared it. I said that the way Jesus was raised is the way we will be raised. That's Paul's argument. And then he goes on to talk about our resurrection, and it's going to happen when? When Jesus returns. But when we die, we're immediately with Christ in heaven. So the resurrection can only be referring to the corpse. And thus, if we're going to be raised physically, Jesus was raised physically. Professor Craffert never addressed this argument. What he did say is that Paul talks about the resurrection and relates to the resurrection body being glorious like the stars. I agree, just like Daniel 12. But he neglected to mention that there's also Jewish literature like 2 Baruch 30, chapters 49 through 51 that mentions the same thing and explains it a little more in depth. Chapter 49, it says, "How are the dead raised?" Chapter 50, "The earth will return them in the same form it received them." Chapter 51, "Once the earth has returned them in the same form it received them, they will be changed to become glorious like the angels and equal to the glory of the stars." This is precisely what Paul says. Because in chapter 15 of 1 Corinthians, he talks about the resurrection, and then in verses 52 and 53, he says, "This perishable will put on," or clothe itself, like putting a jacket on. "This perishable will put on the imperishable. This mortal will put on immortality." And he talks about how the trumpet will blow, the dead in Christ will be raised, and we will be changed. The same word used in 2 Baruch. It's a change, it's a transformation of the physical body, not the taking on of a completely new one while the old one remains in the grave. He mentioned about Grundel's article. I've read that article in the Journal of Anthropological Research. It's interesting, it's spooky. And the anthropologist in there, he got spooked. I mean, he was so spooked by the scenario that the next day he felt like he was going to vomit throughout the entire day. He was really shaken by this. It's a real interesting article about this drummer in Kenya, a musical drummer, and he dies. And the group of dancers, they come and they're dancing around this guy. And he says, then the unthinkable happened. Something horrific happened. All of a sudden, the corpse jumped up and started spinning around and dancing. And then they went up to the rooftop, and he started playing the drums. And he said, like Professor Craffert said, that, yeah, this happened in an altered state of consciousness. But why? Because it couldn't have happened in space-time since these things don't happen. That's a worldview judgment. Mm-hmm. But when you have multiple people seeing the same thing, I would say that's not in an altered state of consciousness. And if it was, I don't think that this is something that's a hallucination. It could be demonic. And in fact, in Haiti, it could even be, I'm not saying the guy didn't rise from the dead in a sense. In Haiti, that's what zombieism's all about. They do these kinds of things and they claim that the corpse actually raises, but it's an evil spirit that gets into the corpse. It's only temporary And just like in this case, after it's over, the body falls back dead into the position it was in. That's not what we're talking about with Jesus' resurrection here. Far from it. So we can see that my five facts still stand. What about method? Well, here I list four criteria for the best explanation. Explanatory scope, and I said the resurrection hypothesis fulfills three of the four with flying colors and doesn't fail the fourth. What about Professor Crawford's? It lacks explanatory scope because it can't account for the appearance of Paul. He never tried to do that. It lacks explanatory power because, as I've shown, it goes against the plain sense of the text. It pushes it and forces it to fit. Third, it's ad hoc because it assumes, it presupposes that the early Christians were referring to cultural experiences with an altered state of consciousness. And I've shown that they had both of them and that these don't fit altered state of consciousness. Plausibility, I think it passes that because it is accepted that altered state of consciousness experiences exist. So whereas the resurrection hypothesis fulfills three of the four and doesn't fail the fourth, Professor Crawford's hypothesis fails three of the four and passes one. We can clearly see that the resurrection hypothesis is the superior historical explanation. Now, let me just make a few final, very quick remarks. He said he's embarrassed to participate in the discussion. I'm not. I think that this is a very important discussion. It affects worldview. And if Jesus didn't rise, Christianity's false. I don't want to be a member of a false religion. And I want to go ahead and I want to practice, if Christianity is true and Jesus rose from the dead, that gives us a lot to think about. And it tells us God loves us. He really loves us and cares for us. He says that most Christians believe on our tradition. Well, that's a genetic fallacy. It's saying why, we're not discussing this evening how someone came to believe something. I might have come to believe something for the wrong reasons. It doesn't matter. We're just talking about did Jesus rise physically from the dead? And if you believe that, is it a correct belief? I think it is. Finally, he talks about the ethical objection, and he says that, hey, this is unethical to claim that Christianity is true because then you're saying all other religions are false. Well, if Christianity is true, then all other religions are false. And whether people like that or not, I mean, okay. But my mom has cancer. And when she found out about stage 4 breast cancer that had spread to her lymph nodes and back, that was really bad news for her. And the doctor said, I've got bad news, and here's what you got to do. And went through all this stuff and says, it's going to be the worst time in your life. But if you want any chance of surviving, you got to do it. That was tough. I think it would have been unethical, would have been for that doctor to say, but here's what I recommend, but there are people who would say that may not help and just think positive, eat some more chicken soup and you'll be just as good. And who am I to say they're wrong? That's unethical. Well, we're not talking about someone's life here. We're talking possibly about the potential eternal destiny of one's soul. And so I don't think it's unethical if we're talking about a question that talks about whether Christianity is true. The Apostle Paul himself said, if Jesus Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. So, like he says a few verses later, in that case, let's go party, for tomorrow we die.